Alright people, welcome back to the Pile of Commodore 64s, and today we are going to attempt to get one of the three computers working. And a big issue with these three was the PLA chip. And why the PLA is so important is because the CPU in the Commodore 64 has a 64K address space. And it also has 64K of RAM. And that is a problem because it has a lot more to address, for example, the ROMs, the cartridge port, the I.O. So 64K of address space is not enough. So the PLA helps by switching out and in different banks of the memory to address some of these areas that can't be reached. Now, this task is not trivial because the timing is very crucial. When you switch out areas of the memory, you need to make sure that it shows up to the CPU in the right time. And some PLA replacements are known to have issues with exactly this. The replacement I had on the shelf is an older one. It's one I bought from FPGA Arcade back in 2012, and it doesn't exist anymore. But the most trusted one right now, I would say, is the PLAnkton. And I got one because these are super cheap now. You can get them for like $15. And I thought it was worth to have an actual tested and reliable PLA replacement in the computer I am going to repair now to make sure that this won't be an issue. Of course, I will save the other replacement for future testing and see how good it is. But we can see that they are very, very similar. And under this label, where it says C64, there is another chip that looks very much like the PLAnkton one. They are both programmable logic devices, but they are different brands, so we can be sure they don't have the same code on them. Now, in the previous episode, I realized that Exhibit B was probably the most repairable one. It does look good, and the only thing with this is that it has an English keyboard, which is a very common computer. Exhibit A has a Swedish keyboard, and it sort of convinced me that Exhibit A is probably the one I want to repair. But B certainly looks a lot cleaner and not as yellow, so I will swap over the board and the keyboard into that case. Now, some might say that this is, you know, ethically wrong. But considering these are not the original boards anyway for these computers, so it doesn't really matter. What matters though is we need to get rid of this cardboard. This cardboard is gonna kill it. Alright, so that's empty. We have this LED also, but it actually just snaps in, so it's an easy fix. Now, let's go for a shower. That was refreshing. Now, some of you might like, you know, to watch people clean, so this is your part. I won't say much. I'll just, you know, clean. I love cleaning. Hooray. And the table. As for the board, I have used some compressed air on it to get rid of the dust. I have also moved over the SID chip from computer B, which is a little bit of a mystery still. We are not 100% sure that the SID chip is actually working. Okay, this little hole here is broken, but I think it'll hold the bracket in place. Seems fine. And we'll see what the diagnostic cartridges say about this machine after we're done. Also, it'll give us a chance to test the SID chip. But before we can test the SID chip, after we're done with putting this computer together, I will make a cable, an S-video cable, to get the best possible picture out of it, and also two connectors for stereo sound. Of course, this has one SID chip, but it is possible to put two SID chips in a Commodore 64 and thus get more channels and stereo configuration. And for those of you who want to know how I clean the keyboard, I use this one and some isopropanol and a little bit of boredom. And now it's time to put in the PLAnkton, the PLA replacement. It sits up here on this board, which is the opposite arrangement to the SID to some of the other boards. So you need to make sure you don't put it in the wrong socket. Again. And there we go, a nice looking Commodore 64. Let's continue with the video cable. That was a bit cheesy, but here's the cable. And I used the instructions from this blog. I will avoid pronouncing the name, but it has great information in it. For example, choose the right plug. There are two different 8-pin plugs, and they look different, so you need the horseshoe type. Also, I have decided to put the second audio channel on pin 7, because this is the recommended pin to use in many of the stereo modifications. Time to plug this in, and also I will plug in a tape player, the data set, so that we can try some game on it later. People always forget to rewind. Okay, so I put two more diagnostic programs on this dead test cartridge that I made, and I'm going to start with the diagnostic program that doesn't require an external diagnostic harness, because I don't have one. Well, it starts up, and well, the picture looks quite okay. There's a little bit of graininess in it, and the noise from the sound is also a little bit... Yeah, maybe I will need to change some capacitors in this computer in the future. But so far it looks okay. Now here's something that I expected actually. The ROM check says bad, and that basically means that you have a broken ROM. But in this case, it's a compatibility issue with the Swedish ROM in the computer. The diagnostic cartridges usually only work with English ROMs. But I will switch to the other diagnostic program, which does require a diagnostic harness. But if we ignore the errors, it will still go through all the tests, which is a good thing, because in the end, it tests the SID chip, which is currently untested, and it'll be interesting to see if it has survived all of these years, considering it's also the first version of the SID chip. Good luck to us. That was beautiful. I'm so happy. And that actually concludes this episode. We have a complete repair of Exhibit A. But I will challenge you to do something that not many people have experienced today. Back in the days of the Commodore 64, you could be very sure that the neighbor's kid had a Commodore 64 that was exactly as horrifyingly slow as yours. They might have had more accessories, but there were no faster graphics or faster CPU. You had to put up with the same tape load as any rich kid on the block. And I'm going to, actually already started it, load a tape game live for you to experience the agony. Yeah. Probably that. And I'm going to check the YouTube stats afterwards, how many of you actually managed to stay until the end. And for the rest of you, those of lesser strength, thank you for watching. I hope you subscribe to this channel, and if you want to support it, check out my Patreon page below. Thank you, and good luck with the watching. I crashed.